Shades of Migraine, a podcast series created by the Association of Migraine Disorders. Migraine isn't black and white. It's blurry and shadowy. But there are many forces at work trying to change how we think about and deal with this disease. Today we will be hearing from Dr. Robert Shapiro, a neurologist who specializes in headache disorders. He's also a professor of neurological sciences at the Lerner College of Medicine at the University of Vermont. Dr. Shapiro will be talking to us about the financial burden of migraine disease, increasing pain research funding, headache on the Hill, and the opioid crisis.
It's a real honor to be here. This is a fantastic organization, and it's a great event. And I'm going to speak today about the need for increased research related to migraine and other headache disorders. And there really is a huge disparity, a huge deficiency in the amount of available funds for understanding migraine and for actually coming up with leads towards new therapies. I'm principally going to be talking about federal funding for research. There are a handful of critical sources for pilot grants. This organization, the Association of Migraine Disorders and the Migraine Research Foundation, have been heroically funding small grants for some time. But really the big pot of money that we need, the big mountain that we need to move, is the federal mountain. So there really is insufficient money for migraine research, and insufficient relative to what? Relative to how much we would all want, which is a relatively large sum. But I think the best way to think about it is relative to the burden that migraine imposes. And when people talk about burden, in this context, they're typically talking about either how many people have it, how many people die from it, how much disability it causes, how much it costs. And these are all different ways of measuring burden. And by every one of these measures, except perhaps fatalities, migraine is grossly underfunded. So how do we look at this? So the principal burden for migraine really is disability. And we're trying to align migraine funding with how much that burden is. So for the last decade, we've gone to Washington each year in the late winter when it's cold, but it's an important time from the standpoint of trying to influence legislators. And this was our group this year. In February, we had 93 people from 33 states. A number of people in this room were there. And we visited 158 offices. And every year we try to move the issue a little bit further along. And this year I think we're making some progress. So what's the big problem? The disability problem can be shown here. So everything you see in green is related to the disability of migraine relative to all the other diseases that are within the neurology realm. So this includes stroke and Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and epilepsy and MS. And what you see is migraine, which is the light green, and medication overuse headache, which is the darker green at the bottom, collectively are more than half of all the disability that's caused by neurological diseases. It's grossly underestimated and underappreciated. Everyone knows about the enormous and growing burden of Alzheimer's disease, but people don't recognize that the considerable burden on people of childbearing age, people in the workforce, is largely related to migraine. So migraine is the leading cause of disability for Americans under the age of 50. So how do we look at migraine funding relative to this burden? So another way to look at burden is to say, okay, how much is the disability, and how many people die from it, and how many people have it? And there's a composite number which the World Health Organization has come up with called the Disability Adjusted Life Year, or DALY. You don't really need to know exactly how that sausage is created, but every disease is assigned essentially a burden on the basis of this. And if you look at the burden, which is down here on this axis, versus NIH funding, you can see that for the 68 different disorders that the NIH has analyzed, which were the complete list that they had data, that there's a relationship between how much the burden is, okay, in this axis, versus how much the funding is. And there really is a line that can be drawn which approximates the predicted funding, if all things were being equal relative to funding and burden. Of course, there are other reasons why funding ends up coming towards diseases. You know, you have to worry about diseases which are emerging, like Ebola. You have to recognize that when there's a particular breakthrough, funding needs to follow that to try to capitalize on that. But overall, there really is a relationship between the amount of funding and the amount of burden. And what you also see is that lying here at the bottom, okay, the furthest away from this line which would be drawn here are migraine and headaches. They are absolutely the most underfunded major disorders in the entire realm that the NIH has to look at. And where should it be? You know, if you were to look at a disorder which has approximately the same burden as migraine, you would look at schizophrenia, which is up here, and it turns out schizophrenia sits almost directly on that predicted funding line. So how much funding does schizophrenia get as a predicted number relative to migraine? It's 14 times more, okay? 14 times more to get to the point where you're at the predicted line relative to the entire universe of disorders which the NIH funds. So this is a view of the NIH data. These are the data that the NIH have presented about how much funding they've made available, or not made available, how much funding of grants that they've funded are related to migraine and headache disorders. And you can see initially when we got our advocacy efforts going, there was a notable increase and we were feeling pretty good about ourselves, even though we probably weren't responsible for this. But nonetheless, things really stalled around 2014. And with the current president's budget, there's a predicted 20% drop in migraine research funding in 2018, assuming that the president's budget is fully enacted. This is a major crisis if this were to occur. But another thing happened in this time frame, which really, I think, points out how we might frame or think about the search for more migraine research funding. And that's the opioid crisis. So the opioid crisis was not a random event. It didn't just kind of happen. It was promoted by criminal marketing of particular pharmaceuticals. And this lit the match, and we have been suffering from this ever since. And you have to ask, these prescription opioids, they were prescribed for something. They were prescribed for pain disorders. And it's not uncommon for people who have migraine to be prescribed opioids. They're typically ineffective for migraine, and they often make the problem worse, but nonetheless, it's a common problem both in emergency departments and among primary care providers. So in recognition of this, in recognition of the idea that if research had come up with remedies for pain, including pain disorders such as migraine, which rendered opioids obsolete, this match might never have been lit back in 1996. So this is pain research funding by the NIH, and you can see it's essentially been flat for as long as that they've been reporting these numbers, except for this projected 20% fall if the president's budget's enacted. And is that enough? Let's think in terms of amount of pain research funding versus its burden. The World Health Organization doesn't have a little dot on that scatter chart for pain, but we can ask, relative to what we know and has been calculated for the cost of pain, chronic pain in the United States, we can compare that to other disorders. And what we see is this: pain by far, it's absolutely incomparable, by far is the most costly single health problem we have, and migraine is bundled into that. It's the only disorder where you have to think in terms of major fractions of $1 trillion a year. This $600 billion dollar amount for pain is undoubtedly an underestimate. There are all sorts of other sources of costs for pain, for instance, people in prisons and in the military, et cetera, which are not calculated in this. So if you add up the cost of heart disease and cancer combined, it's less than the cost of pain each year. And relative to the amount of NIH funding, how much funding comes to pain? You saw in the previous slide that it's about $500 million a year, which is a huge amount of money, but is it enough relative to its burden? What we see is that cancer, relative to its costs, is about 30 times more funded than pain. So what have we been working to do about this? Well, fortunately, we have some great allies in Congress. Last year, and you'll hear a little bit more about this when I introduce Senator Whitehouse, there was a critical piece of legislation to help combat the opioid crisis called the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act, called, or CARA, C-A-R-A. And with the wonderful and huge efforts of Senator Schatz and Senator Hatch, we were able to help include in that bill this piece of legislation, these provisions, which direct NIH to focus on increasing pain research to find leads towards new remedies which are not addictive. And in particular, in here, it's mentioned that the relative burdens of individual diseases, medical disorders, to be regarded as crucial considerations in balancing the priorities of the federal research portfolio. Now, since migraine is on that map as being the most underfunded disease relative to burden, we believe that this legislation, should it be fully funded, will lift all the boats, including migraine research. Included in that is this language, which came out last year's appropriations bill, which specifically directs NIH to focus on the burden of disease, okay, setting priorities for the burden of disease, and the Appropriations Committee supports a focus on conditions in need of further funding, such as chronic pain, including migraine, and other treatment alternatives for chronic pain. So Congress is focused on this, and it's time to actually make some progress with it. So here's some recent developments. By recent, I mean in the last month, things that we should all be excited about, which suggest that there may be some important movement, despite all of the headlines, all the things you read on the front page or the first thing that comes up on Google News. So some of these are a little arcane, but they're really important. So in May, the NIH established a specific group, a study section, to review migraine research grants and pain research grants. This is the first time it's been possible to have a relatively level playing field for grants to be reviewed at NIH. The NIH Director Collins and National Institute of Drug Abuse Director Nora Volko wrote an important piece in the New England Journal that came out on June 1st, which says, "We cannot hope to prevent opioid misuse and overdose without addressing the treatment needs of people with moderate to severe chronic pain." So this is the most important voices at NIH linking this issue of opioid abuse and the opioid crisis with the pain crisis. Further, on June 7th, 73 organizations, including this organization, co-signed a letter to Governor Christie, who is leading the President's Commission on Combating Drug Addiction and Opioid Crisis, and states, "A long-term solution to the opioid crisis will only be achieved by addressing inadequately treated pain." So there's consistency here. Furthermore, Matt Gold, who is a colleague and friend who is a delegate at the American Medical Association, was able to get the American Medical Association to resolve this year this particular resolution that our AMA advocate for current legislation that will increase funding for basic and translational pain research. On June 15th, at a congressional briefing, the neurology director, Dr. Koroshetz, recognized this issue about the underfunding of migraine research and headache research by saying, actually, the worst is headache, the biggest disparity between the prevalence and the amount of NIH money that goes in. So they're aware of this. Finally, only yesterday, before the Health Appropriations Committee, Senator Blunt, who is the chair of that subcommittee, which actually has jurisdiction over the NIH budget, indicated that they intend to not actually make these cuts. This is remarkably welcome news. So the President's budget proposes NIH cuts that, rest assured, the committee will find unacceptable. And then I think the most exciting thing is yet to come, which is that Senator Schatz and my Congressman, Peter Welch, we have drafted legislation, it hasn't yet been introduced, to actually create a Stop Pain initiative. You've heard about perhaps heard about precision medicine and the cancer moonshot. These were innovation projects in this big piece of legislation last year. Well, they're proposing a new large piece of legislation focused on pain. And the first bit of that will be $100 million for next year if it comes about. So with that, thanks very much.
In the episode, we will be hearing from Dr. Richard Bowles, who will be talking to us about comorbidities, cyclic vomiting, abdominal migraine, opioids and the ER, genetic testing, mutations in DNA, and mitochondrial genetics. And thank you for tuning in to Shades of Migraine. For more information about migraine disease, please visit migrainedisorders.org.